Another one of the problems was the trademark restrictions. Let's see. And if you guys actually look at people.debian.org, tilde Evan, ccsummary.html, you can actually see the summary of the issues as I'm kind of going through them. And so, yeah, and the trademark restrictions were the fact that Creative Commons is trademarked and it couldn't be used by anybody else but Creative Commons, which is fine, but it's kind of confusing because you have to refer to the license using the trademark. And so that was one of the issues. And the major issue that is still kind of around in the Creative Commons 3.0 are the anti-DRM clauses. And I kind of think most people here would agree that in general, DRM is a bad thing. Having works that are not restricted by DRM is extremely important. But the problem is that there are a significant number of devices, including, for example, the Sony PlayStation and a couple others, which require that works be digitally signed in some way, shape, or form. For example, even works in Debian's archive have, although it's not really DRM because it's user overwritable, there's some sort of restriction on the default set of packages that can be installed. You have to have packages coming from a place or a repository that's signed with a key that happens to be in the key ring, which has been added using app key or whatever. So a very rudimentary form of DRM, but a type of restriction on the types of works that can be deployed to a device. And so the CC license was written in such a way that it required that works distributed under a CC license not be encumbered by DRM. And the problem with that is that normally the proper way to write such a license, or in my opinion, the proper way to write such a license is to allow a work to be distributed with DRM concomitant with a non-DRM distribution. In that way, you have full rights to distribute the work because it's not, you have a copy that is not DRM encumbered, and you have a copy that is DRM encumbered for whatever stupid device you're using, but that's the only way that it will allow to work. Unfortunately, and this is really where the breakdown came, we were unable to completely convince Creative Commons of the necessity for very specific devices of allowing this sort of dual nature distribution. And because of the complexity of the language required to specifically state that, okay, in the case where you distribute a DRM encumbered, you must also distribute a non-DRM encumbered version, was basically lost on the cutting room floor. Because it was a complexity of the license, it did make the license more difficult to understand for people who were not used to reading licenses. And a significant number of people who were on the DRM advisory board, the CC advisory board, weren't necessarily, or weren't cognizant of the need for distribution DRM encumbered to specific works. So they thought that by making, their logic is in effect that by restricting this class of works from being playable on players that only accept DRM works, that they would undermine the commercial applicability of DRM only players. Which is, I mean, it's kind of a convincing argument. Which is kind of a convincing argument, but not necessarily useful for pre-existing devices, which have, I mean, obviously the PlayStation stuff has been broken forever, but it is technically a form of DRM. So that's, in a nutshell, as convoluted as I made it, the issues that we are facing. And why this is important is because, as you know, there's a large number of works under Creative Commons license, and a lot of people are writing stuff under Creative Commons. And we would very much like to have all these works available in Debian, to be able to upload them to main, because there's a lot of documentation that people are writing under Creative Commons. There's a lot of neat pictures, games, sound files especially, that people are licensing under Creative Commons, and we'd like to be able to include them. But basically, until those issues are ironed out, the first two that I talked about have been, but the DRM one is ironed out. It's not necessarily clear that they can be incorporated into DEMA. What it basically has to happen is we'd have to have a GR or something, or FTP master would have to overrule DEMA legal to say that, hey, these works. Yeah, I mean, it's pretty rare for, DEMA legal tends to be much more conservative than the project as a whole, but it only happens in cases where, like, the only one I can think of is GFDL works, and it was very much a compromise about this work set.
So,
would
all CC licenses have this anti-DR clause, or?
Yes, the question is do all CC licenses have this DRM clause? And yeah, it's not one of the add and take away clauses, it's present in all of them. I should of course mention that there are of course cases or classes of CC licenses which are inherently incompatible with the DFSG. The non-commercial and some of the other ones, but the base course has this DRM restriction, which is problematic. Okay, so is there anything that I've missed? Or any other things if you want to? I mean, I'm not entirely sure exactly what Evan was going to hit at, but that's kind of the overview.
You talk about trademark restrictions. Is this actually a problem?
It's not really much of a problem because it's basically, it's been fixed now in the 3.0 version. And it's only the fact that you couldn't refer to Creative Commons. So it says that you. Wait, the last time
it wasn't meant to be in there. As a notice, it wasn't meant to be part of the license, but it wasn't quite clear that it wasn't.
Right.
So people kept including it, and that might have been nonsense.
Right. Yeah, so as far as I know, the 3.0 version, they've made it very, very clear that that's not a part of the license. And there may be some still 2.0 version works that had that basically trademark bit still in it. But assuming you talk to the licensor, they should be able to remove it.
Is that like a clause at the end of GPL that says Tycoon, the example, and something was bundled with license?
Oh, yeah. That's a little different because there's verbiage in the GPL which specifically states that this is how you would license stuff under the GPL.
And this wasn't marked.
Yeah, exactly. It's sort of, and a lot of the licenses appear to be part of the license, which it wasn't intended to be. I think it was a clause that was at the bottom of the web page, saying that like a footer that was on all CC web pages, and people when they were licensing their stuff just copied it in because it was there. Apparently there wasn't a HR bar or something to delineate it.
Can we not make random comments about the issue?
Yeah, sure.
I need a microphone or something. I guess come up. Do we have another mic?
Should I use this one?
No, I can just use this one here. Why don't we get this one?
So,
since I have a little
bit of a big one. The mic around. It was unclear to me how the Creative Commons, same project, tries to address the issue of non-licensing stuff freely by the users of like digital cameras. You know, their primary example that I heard said that we want to have an easy selection of licenses so that maybe Panasonic or Sony can implement a camera where you take a photo and then the camera asks you which CC license do you want and then you just click and everything. So how does their stance that DRM is completely out of the question, how does that go hand in hand with the collaboration with the industry? So did they explain this this strange situation?
Yeah, I'm not sure that they had a very good explanation for it.
They just thought it was a good idea at the time.
Yeah, well part of the thing is, part of the issue is they both want to have CC everywhere, and so they were thinking that it was more consumer-facing, probably that part. And whereas the other issue is combating the media and entrenched media companies, which very much is the battle that CC is primarily looking at. they're not like we are, we're looking to add, we're primarily looking at free software, computers to be free. They're primarily looking at the issue of FIDA, EPA, RIA, and the various authors restriction groups.
Doesn't that sound like they're picking up on the Free Software Foundation vibe rather than the let's do something productive Debian vibe? You know, aren't they a bit extreme if they are doing something that general?
I don't know if you could say it's extreme, because Debian sort of has both aspects as well.
Yeah, but we have both aspects, and they seem to have the...
Oh, sure. Well, at the end of the day, CC isn't making works.
Yeah.
It's enabling authors to license their works in a specific way. Whereas at the end of the day, Debian is making a distribution. It happens to be a free software distribution, which is kind of interesting too, because at the end of the day, the Free Software Foundation, well, and its sub-project, GNU, is making a free operating system.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a different thing. Whereas
Three different viewpoints, standpoints.
Right. So, I don't know. I'm not up enough on CC's internal politics. It's hard enough to stay with Debian's
internal politics. We have no politics of our own. It sounds a bit, strange. They're like an artsy bunch. They're not computer oriented, and yet they see the DRM as the great evil, and then they want to eradicate it like that. So it's inconsistent in my mind. Maybe for them it's inconsistent, but...
Yeah, well, I think part of the thing is a lot of them actually use these types of media devices that have been covered.
Uh-huh, so it's a backlash.
Right. I mean, one of their famous spokespersons is Corey Doctorow, and he does a lot of...
Sorry, can you repeat it?
Corey Doctorow. He's a sci-fi author. He's a lot of talks. He's a new guy. But anyway, he's had a lot of experience with DRM devices and the issues around it. Because it's sort of looking at it more from the consumer aspect. Whereas in the computer realm, we got stuck with the fact that we couldn't use the source code to modify it. They're getting, I can't play my media that I purchased on any device that I want, or books that I've written.
It's like if we were out to get compatibility and interoperability on Windows instead of making our own operating system and the freedom of the... Doesn't that sound like a good analogy? They are going out into the existing proprietary world and then trying to fix that.
Kind of, but really what they're doing is they're trying to propagate to other... They're sort of doing the advocacy part that the Free Software Foundation does.
Uh-huh.
So, only some software of the Epicenter is actually written and by people who are paid,
mm-hmm.
otherwise directly launching the SFS. A lot of the software is just people who say, hey, I agree with what Epicenter says, I'm going to license my work under the GNU GPL, which is basically what the CC, it's that aspect of the CC is doing. So they're trying to convince the creators of the work, same thing like Epicenter, convince the creators of the work to license it. But yeah, they do have slightly different philosophical backgrounds behind what they're doing.
I'll turn the mic over to someone else.
I understand you're not leading the session, but what's the purpose of this? What's the purpose of the session? I think we're fairly clear on the information front of it now. We understand the problem. So what precisely is the problem for Debian? What's the purpose of the session? So I guess, what are we going to do about it?
Okay, so as much as I could infer from the title of the talk and everything, what would be best is if we could come up with some sort of understanding of what went wrong, why we were able to convince CC of the difference between the philosophy, and what we can do in the future, both with CC and because we're going to run into this issue, and we've run into it again with Sun's CDL, for example, and we're going to continue to run into it. What can we do to convince people who have different philosophies that our philosophy is the one true philosophy and their heritage?
Yeah.
But or at least that it's try to come to our point of view or to meet someone in the middle so that we can have some sort of work that will be compatible with the industry.
Very clear. So there's been a start of convincing them that it's been rejected. So what precisely is the problem for Debian? Is it the inclusion of certain things which are unnecessary nonsense within the Debian distribution legitimately?
Right, exactly. That's what we'd like to be able to do. And I think to just resolve the last couple of issues, either there's no ways that could be done, either by directly asking creative problems or possibly by talking to the authors to get a specific grant to work around a little bug would also be
sensible. That makes sense, no, that sounds like a clear statement of what needs to be done. Thank you.
No problem.
We have an example of any software or
like a package which is licensed under GNOME, GPL. It comes with a set of SVG pictures that an artist drew, and the artist said, "I want this to be share alike or something." It's pretty common. Do we reject the package or do we keep it?
Yeah, currently we reject.
Currently reject. So, what is the exact advice given to maintainers? Well, what do you do? Like, go to the upstream and just yell at them? You are silly, or do you do a license? Is there an exact clause to be added? You know, verbiage already written. What do people do?
I mean, from my perspective, what I would recommend that upstream authors do is try to license everything in the work under the same license. So if they've got graphics in a GPL work, the graphics should be detailed. And especially in the case of SVG, there's no question what the source code is. It's the SVG file. And so, yeah, they should definitely, I mean, to the extent possible, they should license it under the same license, or, yeah, that's what they should do. And it's fine if they want a dual license. We don't care so long as there's some pathway through the licenses that are available. That's the MSG group. That's good. One example that recently came up that's kind of interesting is music files, I think for Friends on Fire, that came up because one of the authors is in Finland, which has some sort of weird, perhaps it's not weird. Maybe only weird from my American perspective, but a compulsory copyright assignment for real live artists, where this group that they assign their copyright to collects royalties for the author. And any work that you create is automatically has its copyright assigned to this group who supposedly collects the royalties for you. And you can't collect any royalties without signing a contract to assign. So that's another issue that sometimes comes up in this related case. That's another thing that we're working on.
Question about the moral authority aspect of it, because with this Creative Commons work group, there's sort of various people who are sort of appointed or invited onto it, which, were drawn from Debian Legal's members. But then at the end, we have Creative Commons coming back and saying to us, no, the DRM, it can't be a problem because there's been this boast about the FDL. Did we have the moral authority? And do you think groups like this should have the moral authority, or should everything go through sort of a vote of developers, GR or something? Or how could we actually have some moral authority to use with the likes of Creative Commons without them or other groups be able to come back and tell us what Debian's view is? Do you have thoughts on that? Do other people have thoughts on that one?
Yeah, that's actually a good question. It's one good question.
Sorry, just a brief answer. I think you have moral authority, but only in the group of people, in the subset of people who believe in Debian. Mm-hmm. If the issue is how far the moral authority spreads. Do the Creative Commons guys realize the problems they're causing for the Debian project?
Yeah, I mean, personally, I don't know. It's always a question when you're dealing with subgroups of the project, exactly how far a small subset can speak for the whole. And so it's a very thorny question that I'd like to avoid as much as possible by claiming that I only speak for myself, which of course I'm doing now. But yeah, it is a good question. I don't know how we can really convey that, because Endymion sort of has a very anarchistic organization, and there's no real way to say the project says unless you do it as a GR. I mean, even the DPL, while you can make decisions on behalf of the project, he's still subject to being overridden by a GR. And so there's a limit to the amount of a single person or a small group can do. I mean, I think besides packages, that's about the limit of a DD's authority. So, yeah, that is a good question. I think the best thing that can be done is to make the process as public as possible, and people who disagree within the project, their disagreement made as publicly as possible, so that it's obvious, or relatively obvious, what who has consensus and who doesn't. Yeah. I don't really have a good solution for that. It's a question that I get asked. I was just asked in the CDDL, or on DEVIL, how does legal speak for the project when it's been opened by GFDL? And there's not really a good answer. So.
I don't believe it was.
Sorry. Let's have this intriguing political discussion. The overriding was a pragmatic one. We decided that the anti-DRM clause in the DFSG was set aside, the problem was set aside, because the option was, let's just release Sarge, or Edge. Or,
right, it was Sarge.
Sarge, yeah. So, it was a subjective vote, basically. We weren't deciding on the legal matters, we were deciding on the whole timing, on the future of Debian, if you will. At that point, it wasn't just let's strike down the legal thing, or let's kill the legal team because they are so cool. It was okay. Let's do the let's just get past the issue.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I'm not trying to say that it was a direct. I thought I did say it was a direct. I mean, I meant that it was a case where legal had thought that it was an issue that needed to be resolved completely, and in some cases was much more conservative in that aspect of the project, which wanted to be more pragmatic, which is always a question, because the people who usually are looking at the licenses tend to be more conservative, or nitpicky, basically, than the project as a whole, which wants to get on with it and make a distribution.
Which is all right.
Yeah, exactly. It's definitely a balance between the two.
Just something about the Sarge and FDL link. The vote about releasing Sarge, even with non-free documents, was July 2004. And then there was another one about the FDL in April last year. And I think the second of those, the sort of general statement about the FDL,
It was about Edge, because we were thinking that we have only 6 months for Edge to get released at that point. Can you repeat the date, please?
Yeah.
July.
April 2006.
April. And we were thinking December.
Please use your microphone.
Yeah.
was the April one the one that I wrote? I don't remember.
April 2006, the original text, I think, is Anthony Towns.
But he withdrew it.
No, for whatever reason, the primary option was still that, but then it was actually an amended one that was passed. I can't remember who wrote that, and I've got that in my notes.
Okay.
Yeah. Which means we have to actually just slide aside. We have a slightly fun thing. We have a position statement that says why the FDL is not acceptable for Debian, which explains why it is.
Yeah.
It was. Let's get back to the matter of who gets to speak for whom. I think that this whole situation put the FTP master team between a rock and a hard place, because they are the ultimate, you know, deciding authority. You know, they can claim, oh, Debian legal team said do that, but it wasn't the Debian legal team doing anything. They were going through with that, and they were filing papers with the whatever agency in America. You know, legal liability was theirs actually. So we're not making much sense about that whole thing, but about the moral authority issue, I think we still have a moral authority as a whole. Yeah, each of the three you know, entities in the whole process make up a whole, which is of course amorphous. It's like an amorphous blob of opinions and statements and yelling and shouting and being calm and everything. But the moral authority is still in within our you know, there it exists. You know, it's not articulated. It's not made into a position statement or anything, but there is still the whole thought about Debian. And now about the Creative Commons thing. They do not have any moral authority, in my opinion. The FSF has moral authority because they actually did produce software that was licensed under the GPL and the LGPL and the other licenses, even the GMDL that we all love to hate. They did produce stuff under those licenses. So they have the credit, they have the street credit, you know, about that. And they have the authority to say, okay, we did the, you know, what do you call it, principal thing, and it worked. But the Creative Commons did nothing. They just recommended to other people do something that is principled, and we support you. Yeah. There's a gaping hole.
Yeah, well, I think part of the issue, too, is that the governance structure of CC isn't as clear. Although I have to admit that FSF has this issue as well, because it's not entirely clear at FSF who, besides RMS, has the final say. Whereas at Debian, it's quite clear. The final say, comparatively,
documented it,
but yeah. I mean, the final say rests with developers. At the end of the day, I mean, that's who either by not doing anything tacitly affirms, or by GR and overruling sets what happens.
So in a sense, I was saying we have the authority, and we should be able to override either through saying we have the moral authority, or either through saying we are smarter than you, or either through saying this is our argument, listen to us, or be condemned to eternal stupidity. You know. We have this sway, we have this power, because we do something with the whole thing.
Yeah. Although we have to be careful too, though, because people in CC, they actually do works as well. So, I mean, even though the group as a whole, its job isn't to make works, right? There are members of it who do. So, I mean.
In a much less articulated way than ours.
Yeah, and that may be why it's more diffuse. I mean, and it's not so clear exactly who's making the decisions there.
Or why.
But of course, it's probably the same if you're outside of Debian. Yeah. And looking at it, it's probably difficult to see how these things are.
Yeah,
so
it's like,
whereas, yeah, it's really obvious.
The actual problem I think we have with them is not whether they make this decision, it's whether they influence through their media campaigns and whatever they do, because they do stuff, you know, they have this propaganda machine, basically, that is actually a good thing, and it's one day it may outgrow their current state, and they will become a bigger thing than Debian. So at that point we have a real problem, because...
Well, I think you're absolutely right. I think that the number of works that are CC licensed now probably exceeds the number of works that are GPL. I don't know the exact numbers, but I would not be surprised if that was the case.
When that becomes by a magnitude larger, then we can talk.
But yeah, it could very well be, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Sorry, I came in late, so I didn't catch the beginning of all of this. Can you just quickly outline which CC licenses are an issue, or are they not an issue?
Sure. Yeah, it's what we're talking about was the server in. When it started, but we had it in 2000.
exactly, a 2005 bit group of people, a subset of legal, who were trying to convince Creative Commons to resolve a couple of issues, generic issues with their license. There are obviously a set of classic CC licenses, the non-commercial licenses, that cannot be used in periods because they're incompatible with the DSG. But there were a couple of minor technical issues with the license and the inability to distribute DRM encumbered works using a CC license. That was problematic for the DFSG. And the reason that is because we couldn't both distribute a DFSG encumbered work alongside a non-encumbered work for use in things that are totally broken and only accept DRM, things like some PlayStation games, for example. And to a lesser extent, even the archive has some sort of restriction on it, because you can't, by default, install packages without overwriting that aren't signed. So that was basically a minor issue that we thought was obvious, and everybody would agree with us, but at the end of the day, we weren't able to convince Creative Commons that they should allow parallel distribution in their anti-DRM clause. So that's basically the issue, and we're sort of talking about why that happened, why we weren't able to communicate the consensus from Debian very well to Creative Commons, and sort of guessing in a general sense of what Evan is actually going to talk about, because as you know, I'm not Evan. Thank you very much, and feel free to ask Evan what he was actually going to talk about, because he probably has some insight.